Sí,
sí.
Sí, sí.
So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers, especially for inviting me and part of my group. And yeah, I think you have heard a couple of experimental procedures we are doing in our lab. And I try to embrace now the clinical issues we have to deal with new technologies. And for that, I would like to jump straight into the problem we are dealing with. So, of course, we are purely a research lab focusing on tumor biology. However, that we are driven by the hallmarks of the clinical signs of tumors. And in particular, we are working with gliomas, so these are specific brain tumors. And one of the characteristics of these tumors, which are specific to brain tumors, is that they do not metastasize. However, they do grow invasive, and they are also characterized by the high proliferation, meaning this is quite similar to other tumors as well. What are the clinical concerns of such tumors is that when you see here, these are MRI scans, T1 weighted images, and you see the primary tumor, and then when you switch to the T2 images, you see that the total volume of the tumor is much, much bigger. So this is really a hallmark of these tumors. The more malignant they are, the huger the brain edema they induce. So the brain swelling, what you see. And this is also concerned from a clinical point of view, because patients die from the edema, not primarily from the tumor. So, of course, there's a lot of interest in how come that these tumors expand in this way, even though you see the little knot here is quite small. Well, there's one point we think which contributes to the edema, and that is the tumor angiogenesis, so vessel growth. Again, a characteristic which is not particularly specific to brain tumors, however. And secondly, that the brain swelling is mediated in an independent pathway. And I try now to convince you that we believe we have a clue on what's going on, and we think that there's a central part which has been missed so far in the concept of brain tumors, and that is active neural cell death induced by these tumors. And how do these tumors produce this? Well, the brain swelling is actually, when you look through the literature and textbooks, there are two, let's say, concurring theories. One is that there's a cytotoxic event, which then causes brain swelling. And secondly, that there's a vagogenic event, which then causes brain swelling. And we believe that there's a link between these two processes, and that this is the glutamate transporter XCT. So in the following minutes, I would like to talk about this transporter and what we are doing to get hands on it by imaging means. Very briefly, this glutamate transporter is a transmembrane protein which shuffles glutamate out. And as you know, glutamate is a neurotransmitter in the brain. It's an amino acid, and it's also a neurotoxin. So in high concentration can kill neurons, and in high concentration even glial cells. Now, so this was one of the very, very, let's say, ugly experiments, because what we did here is we implanted a tumor which expresses a reporter, you see this is GFP, into the brain in living animals, and then we wanted to access the tumor microenvironment. How do you do this? Well, first of all, you need to know where is the tumor, and secondly, then you need to distinguish to the normal brain area, which is quite hard. And then place an electrode into it. What you can do then is you can take up fluids, you can measure, you have then access to the microenvironment. And so we did, and what we did was to profile the metabolic secretome of these tumors, and we did it in a very poor man's approach, just by simple HPLC at that time. And what you see here is that in wild type tumors, you have up to 10 micromolar glutamate in the extracellular space. And as I told you, the glutamate transporter XCT is mainly cause for this glutamate. So when you knock down this glutamate transporter, then you see also reduction of glutamate. Not completely diminished, but significantly. I mean, we are talking about concentrations which are neurotoxic in this pattern. So to give you an idea, what we did was now to implant tumors in animals, let them grow, and then do MRI imaging. And this is a reconstruction of the MRI imaging. What you may appreciate is that when you focus on the tumor volume, shown here in purple, that wild-type tumors have almost the same tumor volume as the XCT knockdown, meaning the glutamate-deficient tumors. So still, there are differences. And this is what you see here, colored in yellow. This is the edema. So you see that the brain edema takes a lot of the total volume of these tumors, which you can reduce by blocking the glutamate transporter, as you can see here. So there we have evidences that the glutamate transporter can influence the total tumor volume, which is clinically significant. I don't want to embarrass you now with all the clinical testings. This is now just what we see. So where's the link to the angiogenesis and cell death? Well, first of all, when you now do an experiment, and you may can recall Ali's talk yesterday when he presented the Vogen technique. This is exactly what we did here. So we slice the brain with all the advantages that you now can image the tissue, you can image the interaction between tumors and the brain tissue. And when you then stain, in this case, now here in red, cell death, and you see that the wild-type tumor uses a lot of cell death. Normally that shouldn't be that rich. When you perform the same experiment by knocking down XCT, you see that there's a slightly reduced PI stain, meaning cell death stain. Well, what is even more interesting is when you're now, unfortunately it's the same color, but the border, you see here that these are the vessels surrounding the tumor here in green, as I told you, reporter expressing tumors, and comparing then the vascular pattern of the XCT, but then you see there's quite a reduction of vessels. And vice versa, when you now overexpress the glutamate transporter, and first of all, you see that there's a huge amount of cells going around, and you see that there's a completely aberrant signature of vessels, and even an increase in, we say, pathological vessels. Now, that where's the evidence that this is really glutamate? Well, first of all, we did collect conditioned media from these tumors. So we used conditioned media for water tumors, knockdown tumors, and XCT overexpression tumors. And we treated then Orty Green. So that's an old assay to analyze endothelial sprouting. What you can see here is that when you use conditioning from XCT overexpressing tumors, which also show more glutamate extracellularly, you see that those endothelial cells start to spot much stronger than in the circulation of the wild type. And when you knock down the glutamate transporter, then you see a reduced endothelial sprouting. So that was the first evidence. But this doesn't tell anything about that glutamate is here causative influence in this phenomenon. So for that, again, we used Ali's technique. But in this case, we did not implant a tumor. Rather than used a swamp, so to speak, a little tiny tissue, which we soak up with glutamate, place it on the brain tissue, and analyze that, so that you can see here. And again, the same picture. You see that glutamate-soaked little swamps do induce a lot of aberrant growth of endothelial cells in comparison to controls. So this is the first, let's say, direct evidence that glutamate influences these vessels. So we went further on, and I mean, if you put a theory on top, meaning that glutamate is causal for this phenomenon, then it should be somehow receptor triggered. So glutamate is quite tricky because there are a lot of receptors which respond to glutamate. So we use now a whole battery of pharmacological inhibitors, and while making a long story short, we used in particular MK, which blocks then the inotropic glutamate receptors, and you see that you then can reduce these endothelial sprouting compared to glutamate-treated aromatic rings. So this now gives us quite a strong clue that glutamate via its receptor acts on endothelial cells. Well, and you can even proceed, in this case here we use the retinal tissue. Well, this is a state-of-the-art tissue for analyzing angiogenesis and response, and we can see that glutamate reduces such endothelial tip sproutings, which can be blocked when you use the glutamate receptor blocker MK. Now, well, this might be not so much convincing as long as you do not believe that these endothelial cells express also the receptors. And in fact, they do, as you can see here, and standing in green. This is NR1. It's a particular subunit for the NMDA receptor, the inotropic glutamate receptor. And you see that those endothelial cells from aorta or from brain endothelial cells do express it. And they do express a couple of subunits of this NMDA receptor, as shown here by QRT piece. And, well, this is just a test we had to do because Regius asked for. And that is, do these endothelial cells respond towards glutamate? This is a response you would expect when you stimulate the NMDA receptor. And yes, they do. When you see the phosphorylated act, then you see that glutamate do, the treatment with glutamate do phosphorylate this signal protein in endothelial cells. So we have quite some evidence that here glutamate is in the place of endothelial cells. But still, and that's how science works. We had to go further on. And what we did now is we used the genetic model in which we now wanted to knock out the NMDA receptor in particular endothelial cells. Well, this is not a big story because in fact the NMDA receptor knockout mice are available for now 25 years. And the interesting thing is that those mutants are lethal. They die within the second week postnatally. And guess why they die? They die due to defects in the lungs and lung tissue. And as you know, at that stage, lungs are full of vessels. So there's something already, or there was something already in literature present. However, the problem is when you work on tumor biology and in general work with adult animals, then such a model is not of much help. So we had to generate now tissue-specific knockout by now breeding an endothelial cell-specific Cre mouse with the LOXT NMDA receptor. Genetically, it's called GREEN1. Don't be disturbed, so it's the NMDA receptor. And we did induce postnatally then a knockout. And what you see here is now all the tissue of control animals not treated with tamoxifen, and here induced the knockout. And you see that the sprouting response is much, much lower. And the same is true also for the retina. So we used in vivo this model, injected tamoxifen, so we used the knockout in the eyes. And you see these non-tamoxifen treated compared to those where we induced the knockout. Shows a huge difference in vasculature. So I think we have quite some evidence that glutamate mediates via its receptor endothelial cell sprouting. And in particular in this tumor biology, it's relevant. Because when you're now going back to the model where we now implant tumors with low XCT expression, meaning that they do secrete less glutamate, then you see also that the peritumoral vasculature is reduced compared to wild type. And when you do the same experiment by overexpressing XCT, you see that a huge vascular response peritumorally. So this is back and forth, just showing always more or less the same thing. However, the question then is, are these vessels really functional? I mean, you see that glutamate can stimulate sprouting. You see that those tumors with more glutamate do induce angiogenesis in a stronger way, manner. But what does it mean biologically? Well, for that we had to use a model which, where you drill a hole in the skull of living animals, you put a window, so it's a cranial window technique, and in living cells, by anesthetizing those, you can start then to image, well, let's say till about 150 micrometer deep into the brain tissue. Well, but that is enough to, when you now place the tumor very, very surface near, to see how these vessels are perfused. So you inject the dye intravenously and then monitor the vascular response. You see here wild type situation, very blurry. Yes, that's due to these tumor vessels. Then the XCT knockdown, so reduced glutamate secretion, less blurry. And then those tumors which a lot of glutamate secretion, again, blurry images. Well, what you then can do is you measure functional vessel density, meaning how many vessels are perfused, and you can monitor the permeability and the velocity. So, taking shots, so functional vessel density is increased when these tumors express more XCT. And this is now retro analysis. You see that the permeability of these vessels in XCT knockdown tumors are also increased. That's the reason why these images look so blurry. So these functional measurements show that you have increased vessels, and these vessels are functional but pathological. Let's say they show increased permeability. Well, and last not least, we continue this very old technique. Actually, this is a 100 years old technology from anatomists. It's a technology we use in the first degree medical courses to actually make vessels visible. So what does it mean? It's a technique where you perfuse an animal intracardially with a substance which gets hard. After perfusion, you digest all organic material, and what remains is intravascular tubules. Very simple, very straightforward, and this is how a brain looks like when you completely vascularize the tissue and remove all other material. This is how a mouse. And what are the advantages? Well, the advantages are that you now can analyze bit by bit any tissue in a 3D manner. So a normal histological procedure would not allow you the, let's say, spatial dimension of vessels, whereas with this technique you now can go into it, and this is what our goal was, not to measure the vessels in the tumor rather than the vessels at the border between tumor and normal tissue. So how does it look like, such an analysis? Well, first of all, you need big data systems, because this is a terabyte data set you have to analyze. Well, and then you can monitor and quantify in each direction the vascular extensions. And this is what came out. So you see wild type tumors, central necrosis, you remember, this is always going on with these tumors. So in the heart of the tumor, there's a lot of cells, and then surrounding you see a lot of vessels. This is high magnification. And in those tumors, where you reduce XCT, reduce glutamate, you see also reduced vascular density, especially for these little vessels. And this is when it comes to numbers. So you have a certain normalization of vasculature in tumors where XCT levels are reduced. So I would like to summarize, and that means that with these technologies, you are able then to monitor cell death. You are able to monitor angiogenesis, and I hope I could convince you that XCT seems to be very central in both procedures, or both processes, meaning that, first of all, glutamate is neurotoxic for neurons, and on the same side, glutamate can induce endothelial sprouting, which seems to be an advantage for those tumors. And by this, I would like to mention all the people who contributed to the study, and you see Ali, without moustache, actually. Tina and Luca, a clinician, and well, I'm happy to take your question and you can all see it if you wish. Thank you very much.